Hi everyone, my name is Mike Cook. I work at Queen Mary with the University of London, and today I want to talk to you about some of my research into automated game design and how it intersects with issues in software engineering. So in today's talk, I'm going to start by explaining to you what I mean by the phrase code-based automated game design and a little bit of background on where this idea came from. And then we're going to talk about how code-based automated game design is affected by these very small and sometimes very large, but very everyday decisions that we make when writing code. And finally, I'm going to look at where I think we can take AGD research to mitigate some of these problems and how it might impact the way the games industry adopts our ideas. So typically, for most automated game design systems, they use some kind of game description language to describe the games and the content that they create. So this is a snippet of a game description language from my system, Angelina, that designs games. And this is from the latest version, and you can see here where the first line defines a kind of a condition, a trigger, where a player overlaps an enemy piece. And then in the body of the code, which is activated when the trigger is met, we destroy the enemy piece, we play a sound effect, and then we add one to the player's score. So you can see here, this is fairly straightforward, but the key thing to bear in mind is that these are abstract design languages. They're not programming languages. And they're usually designed to be interesting and useful. They're usually designed to capture a particular space of games. So the video game description language, or VGDL, which is pretty well known, is designed to include a number of classic games from kind of the late 80s, early 90s kind of time. But it's not a programming language in and of itself, although some of them get kind of close. In the paper, we talk about a system that uses Lisp. So game description languages are really useful for a number of reasons. The first is that they solve a lot of the technical problems that come when we want to try and export a game that's been designed by an AGD system. So I've been building these systems for 10 years now, and I have come across all manner of technical issues on different platforms and game engines, and GDLs solve lots of that problem for us because we typically end up just needing to export a text file that can be interpreted somewhere else. They also help because they give us as researchers a shared language that we can all work in. So for instance, many researchers use the VGDL, and that allows them to more easily compare their approaches to a particular problem, which is really useful. However, game description languages have many drawbacks too. So the first of these is that they place fairly unrealistic constraints on how we can actually design games and the limits on how innovative and creative we can be in that space. And this is particularly true when you have something like VGDL, which is defined in terms of classic existing games, especially very famous ones where game designs in the neighboring design space have already been heavily explored by other humans. And it also restricts our ability to learn from others. So in order for a system that works in VGDL to play someone else's game, it would first need to be translated into VGDL. And most game designers are not working in game description languages. They're building their own games using code, using tools like GameMaker. And on that note, game description languages also don't really reflect the way that people build games day to day. So we've already explained how they're not particularly similar to programming languages. And what this means is that even if you use a more visual tool like GameMaker, even those visual tools have more in common with programming languages, I would argue, than they do with game description languages. And this is a problem if we want our AGD systems to one day be integrated into modern game development practices or big game studios. It's going to be harder to do that if the way that they work is clashing in some way with the way that people normally work and the tools that they use. So at this point, I want to introduce this term code-based automated game design. And what I mean by this is a system that doesn't work with a game description language like this, but instead works with actual game code that looks more like this. So this is exactly the same as the game design language snippet that I showed you from Angelina earlier, but it's translated into something that looks a lot closer to C# code. So the way that we define a code-based automated game design system is any AGD system whose outputs and inputs are program code. So instead of working in an abstract design language, it's actually working directly with something like C# in Unity, like this example here. Now, at this point, I wanted to add a little note in, because in the paper, we talk about these systems as if they're kind of hypothetical, like a kind of thought experiment of something that might happen in the future. But in actual fact, we actually have built some of these systems. I do have them working. They're just not quite in a place where I could publish them. So the reason I wanted to point that out here is because the examples that are in the paper and the examples I'm going to bring up in this talk are real. They've come from real things and problems that I've encountered while building these systems. So these aren't hypotheticals. They are actually going to be there in the near future, and we're going to have to find ways to solve them. So before we move on, I wanted to start with a little simple question for you. So imagine we're working at a game development studio and we're going to build our new game, which is a roguelike. And today we're going to write a fairly major piece of code for our roguelike. It's going to be the code that moves objects around the level. So how should we write this method? How should we write this code? Well, obviously you'd need to know a little bit more about the code base and how it was structured and things like that. But there's a few obvious ways that stand out. So these are two ways we might write a move object function. And suppose this is attached to a game object that we want to move. So in the first example, we give it two numbers, x and y, and those become the object's new coordinates. So x and y are the absolute position of where we want this object to end up. And in the example down below, you can see it's almost the same. There's just a small change, which is that instead of setting the positions to the arguments to the method, we actually add those arguments on. And what this means is that the arguments become relative markers of how the position should change. So instead of giving it 4, 6 as the coordinates, we would look at where it was now and tell it to move one space right and one space up. So we would give it a 1, 1 as the input instead. So this is not that interesting, perhaps, and you might be sitting there thinking, well, so what? This is two ways to write a very simple method. You probably might even write it a third way. But there's a little twist here, which is that we're not just building a roguelike, but there's actually a new coworker working for the studio, and it's a tool that we've bought, an AI system, that will help us invent new game mechanics for our roguelike. And what it's going to do is it's going to do a generate and test loop where it makes some code that describes a new mechanic, and it playtests the game with this new mechanic involved, and then it decides whether it should keep it, whether it should show it to us, or whether it should just delete the code. Now, in order for this system to work, it needs to be able to do a few things. So first of all, it needs to be able to execute methods in the game code. It has to be able to access the code that we've written and run it. It also needs to be able to access and read and write to fields and data inside the code base. And probably it's going to want to instantiate types that we've defined. So it may wish to create new enemies or items for the player to find and things like that. So in order to allow the AI to do this, we're going to let it use something called reflection, which might not be a term you've come across before. Reflection tends to be one of those things that you don't need to know about until you really need to know about it. But I'm just going to give you a quick overview of how this works. So reflection is a metaprogramming concept that allows us to write programs that then edit and execute code elsewhere in the code base. So this line of code here, for instance, allows us to get the type of an object, so the type of the player object, and then ask what are all of the methods defined in this type. And then we actually get objects back, a list of objects that describe each method. And we can look at a method and we can say things like, well, how many parameters does this method take when I call it, and what is its return type? And we can even invoke the method and pass arguments to it and tell it to invoke on a particular object. So we could find the player object, find that it has a method called takeDamage that receives an int, and then call that method with an integer. So reflection is really useful, and it allows us to do things which are close to writing code. Now this is not quite the same as generating code, and there are more complex ways to literally output compiled C#, but we're not going to get into that today, so for now we're just going to look at reflection. So if we return to our case study and we return to our two move object methods, what we can now think is, what would this look like if reflection was trying to access these methods and understand them? And actually, it would look like this. The two methods would basically look identical. They're two void methods that are called something. The system doesn't really care what they're called. And they both take two integers as arguments, even though they use those integers in very different ways. And it actually gets a lot worse than this, because our code base probably includes a lot of methods that have this signature. And many of these methods have nothing to do with moving the player. They might be other game functions, like adding score, but they might be things that do things like exit the application or delete all saved player data. And I have had really catastrophic accidents in the past where systems have accessed code that they weren't supposed to and executed it and kind of destroyed permanently some data in the project. So we already have a problem here where the reflection doesn't allow it to fully understand what this code is. So if it's just generating random bits of code that execute methods, it doesn't really necessarily know which methods are safe and which aren't. But it actually gets even worse than this. So if we go back to our first move object example, let's suppose that our level is defined as an array of objects and the player moves around this array. Then there's actually an implied precondition on this method, which says that, well, the coordinates you give me have to be within the bounds of the level. They can't be outside, otherwise that would cause an array index exception at some point. And there's actually a precondition on the other method that we looked at as well. So in the second move object example, we might want to only allow the player to move one square at a time. And in that case, there would be bounds set on the arguments to this method. It can't be less than minus one and it can't be more than one, because that would allow it to move two spaces or more in a single move. So especially if you're a solo developer, but even if you're not, these are often things that we don't make explicit in our code. There certainly are ways to make them explicit, but often we are not encouraged to, or it's easier not to, or maybe we just don't bother today, we'll do it tomorrow or something. So there are ways around this. So for instance, we could write another move object function, and this time we could use an enum. So we could define an enumerated type that describes directions and only allow it to have four values for the cardinal compass points. And what this allows us to do is write a new version of this moveObject method that only takes one of these enumerated type values. And this basically reduces the number of possible ways to call this method from 2 to the 64 for, you know, every type of integer possible, every value of integer, right down to 4, which is really great. So we've added a little bit of specification, a little bit of formal restriction to the way this method is handled. So the advantages of doing something like this for our AI system is that it's much less likely to cause runtime errors, because we've added a bit of formal information that describes how this method should be used. We've restricted the way it can be called. But restrictions usually come with very familiar disadvantages, namely that we're now restricting the way in which it can be used. So although I gave an example where you might not want it to move more than one space at a time, if you do want to allow that as a possibility, if you want to invent a dash move, you can't do that anymore. This method can only be called to move one tile at a time, and you can't even move diagonally in this example. And it also limits the ability to surprise us. So our system might have invented a cool ability where we pass in the player's speed statistic as the argument to the move function. And that means that the faster you are, the more you get to move with this ability. But we can't do that anymore because we've restricted the type that can be passed to this method, and it can no longer mix and match other integers. So there's some give and take here. So we've mentioned code specification at this point, and I just wanted to talk a little bit about what that is in case this is not something that you've come across before. So anytime we describe how we expect code to behave, we are performing code specification. We're writing it, we're sharing it, we're reading it. And code specification comes in two flavors. It can be formal or informal. So formal code specification is usually expressed in terms of logic or mathematics, and it can often be implemented directly in code. So if you've heard of Hoar logic or Hoar triples, this is an example of formal specification. Liquid types are another example, and liquid types are actually implemented in a couple of programming languages like Liquid Haskell. But formal code specification is not as commonly encountered as informal code specification. So anytime you read or write documentation, comments in your code, Stack Overflow posts, chatting with one of your colleagues, or just your mental model of how your game works, all of these things are examples of informal code specification. So they still describe the expected behavior of code, but they are not rigorously expressed. So as you might have gathered so far, AGD systems can only really benefit from formal specification. It has to be something that they can access through code. So this screenshot here is a large comment included in the NetHack source code for humans to read to understand how the display system works. But this is completely invisible to a system that is trying to analyze the code automatically. And we tend to rely on informal specification more often because it's more natural for us, it's easier to edit and change, and it just tends to be less hassle. So there's a lot more examples in the paper of low-level design stuff, like writing a single function and changing a single line of code. But before I closed out the talk, I wanted to just sneak in a bit of conversation about high-level programming concepts. And by that, I mean primarily software design patterns. So in the paper, we talk about model view controller, which is a software design pattern that has certain qualities that might be considered negative for an AGD system. But today, I just want to talk to you about one example of a design pattern, which is the entity component system. So entity component systems are a design pattern, by which I mean a way of structuring our code base for a particular goal, that are commonly used in certain types of video game, like roguelikes or heavily systems-driven games. The way that they work is that everything in the game world is an entity, and entities are compositions of components. And a component is normally a reusable bit of code that defines a particular quality or capability that something has. So in entity component systems, the way that these entities communicate with each other is by sending and receiving messages. And these messages, once they reach an entity, are propagated to all of the components in the entity. And those components then decide if they want to take action as a result of this message. And sometimes this involves sending messages out themselves. So to give you a little worked example here, suppose in our roguelike we have this wooden barrel object. And the things that this barrel can do, well, it can act as a storage container, so we can put items in, get items out, check its capacity, that kind of thing. It's also flammable because it's made of wood, so we give it the flammable component. That means it will react to messages about being ignited. It will also send out messages that set fire to things that are inside it or things that are near it. So in the paper, I argue that entity component systems are actually ideal for working with AGD systems. And one of the reasons for this is that components are extremely self-contained, and the ways in which they interact with one another and with the wider game code base are very well defined. Because they can only send and receive messages, and these messages tend to be defined in the code base and therefore formally accessible by a metaprogramming system. And so what we end up with is kind of the best of both worlds in a sense. So we get the freedom of arbitrary code because we can write whatever code we want inside the code, inside a component, in terms of having its own fields, doing calculations and things. But then when it comes to actually act and influence the rest of the game, it can only do it through ways which are quite well structured. And what this means is that these messages end up acting as a kind of pseudo game design language, except it's one that's been designed by the actual game developers and is being used by them elsewhere in their own hand designed code. The other benefits that they have is that typically the code that we generate inside a component is going to be more relevant, because when you send a message, this message is targeting some aspect of the game's simulation. So it's more likely to have an impact which is measurable and therefore more likely to be evaluated as good or bad. They also reduce the risk of runtime errors, because one of the great things about components and message-based systems is that the default behavior is to ignore a message. So if you send a message to the wrong object, if it doesn't know how to deal with it or how to receive it, it just won't do anything. And finally, they minimize the kind of scope of the code that's being generated. So many components in a systems-driven roguelike can be very short, like 5, 10, 15 lines of code. Obviously, there'll be plenty of components that are very, very complicated, but many of them define very simple, focused, encapsulated concepts. And actually, this is one of the things you want to aim for in an ECS system, is you want to end up with components that are as simple as they possibly can be. And that's really exciting because it means that our AGD system can have a large impact without writing a lot of code. So when I was doing this kind of research, I was really interested in ECS systems, and I tried to look them up online. And there are a few examples, but they're usually in languages that are a bit more esoteric, or they work in a way that I was not expecting. So I ended up writing my own ECS system and open sourcing it for Unity. It doesn't have this nice art, but all of the other code is there. And if you're just curious, if you just wanted like one other person's perspective on ECS systems and how to write them, I'm not an expert, and it's not a particularly good one, but it at least is something that you can explore and have a look, and maybe that will help you find your own way of making them. So before I wrap up, I just wanted to make a few concluding points. I think that code-based AGD systems are the future for automated game design. I think they're super exciting, and I think they complement existing AGD research in a really nice way. But they clash, unfortunately, with some of the very natural ways that we write software on a daily basis. And in some cases, you might have looked at these examples and thought, I would just write safer code. But actually, in the paper, we give examples where even the good and safe way to write a particular piece of code, like encapsulation, can actually obfuscate and make the code more complicated for an AGD system. So there are lots of issues there that we're going to have to learn to navigate, and that might result in new ways of writing programs. However, the good news is that there do seem to be a few changes we can make that are relatively simple and that do massively improve the readability of our code for AI. So perhaps there's hope in the future that we can synthesize some kind of mixed software engineering paradigm where both humans and AI systems get the best of both worlds. Finally, in terms of the next steps for this field, I'm really excited about the potential of entity component systems and how that might help us start exploring this space in a way that is tractable and gives us a bit of a leg up. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you enjoyed this talk. If you want to ask me questions about it or chat with me, I'm always available via email or on Twitter. If you want to look at the GitHub, you'll find the open source ECS implementation. It doesn't have any code-based AGD in there, but it might help you if you're interested in building your own. And finally, I don't know when this talk is going to go live, but I also have a tutorial at CoG this year, which is about automated game design, kind of a more introductory flavor. It also has an open source automated game design system that you might like to play around with. So if you haven't seen that yet, you should be able to find the recording or maybe catch it live. Let me know what you think. All right, thanks very much for listening, and I look forward to catching you at a future conference. Bye.